Lexical semantics has two parts, right? What are the two parts? Lexical, lexicon. What does lexicon mean? What does lexicon mean? Have you heard about this? Lexicon. Words, right? Lexical items. You have a lexicon, which is a collection of words. And then, what are words? What are words? Hey, my class is very simple. I kept asking questions, okay? And you need to keep answering questions. So what are words? That's the basic lesson in Introduction to Linguistics, right? What is a word? How do you define a word? Hello? Recall what you learned in your Intro to Linguistics. What is a word? A word like what? A word like tree? A word like desk? A word like love? Right? Any word. What's unique about words? What do you see? You actually see three funny letters, right? You see four funny letters, four signs, four symbols. But together, this sequence of symbols or the sequence of sounds, tree, when you hear tree or when you see T-R-E-E, this form, okay? This simple form or this simple sign is associated with a what? A meaning. A concept, right? So a word, the basic definition is the association of a unique form with a meaning. Okay? Even for love, this form is associated with an abstract concept, right? Then what about other words like the, a, and? Do they function the same way? Do they function the same way? You see a sign, a symbol, a sequence of letters, a sequence of sounds. Are they associated with a meaning? Yes or no?
No.
No. Why no? They don't have a meaning. Do they? Do they have a meaning? Yes. Hey, these are first year students, okay? Yes, they do have a meaning. What kind of meaning? Is their meaning the same as the meaning of these words? No. What are the meanings these things represent?
Functional.
Yes, very good. What do you mean by functional meaning? Okay, they have a meaning, they have a function in the language. Unlike these words, they have a meaning corresponding to an object in the real world, an experience in the real world, right? So tree, look there, there's a tree there. I can point to an object in the real world. There's a reference for these nouns, desk, very concrete. Clear object in the real world. So we call these content words, remember? Lexical words. And we call these what? Function words or grammatical words because they have a meaning in the grammar within the language. Okay? They are signaling a relation within the grammar. So, very clear idea about what words are. That's one of the basic things in the class, right? Now, why do we study words? Why do we study words? Why are they so important?
It's the basic element in our language.
Very good. Remember the definition of a morpheme is the basic unit of meaning, right? If language is to convey meaning, is to communicate with each other, then you will have to have some basic units to carry meaning, to allow you to express your meaning, right? So these are the basic units which carry meaning. Now, recall what you learned in syntax. Are you taking formal syntax now? How many of you have taken syntax before? Okay. From the very beginning, linguistic studies focus on syntax, right? So you have studies on syntax, semantics, phonology, and phonetics, right? Have you heard about lexicon? Have you had a subject or a course called lexicon or lexical studies? No. So the role of the lexicon in the traditional view of language is very minimal. Why? You just need a dictionary, right? To know all the words. But for a linguist, our job is supposed to analyze the language, the syntactic structure of language. So syntax has always been the major concern in linguistics. How do we put words together? How do we express things in a grammatical way? Right? So syntax has always been the main focus. And where is the lexicon? What's the role of lexicon? They are kind of supplementary. Remember, you have trees, right? You draw trees. So a sentence is like MPVP. You have PS rules. And where is words? You just insert words into your phrase structural rules. Because words are arbitrary. That's the traditional assumption, right? You can study syntactic rules. Every sentence has to have this structure. So we call this what? Grammaticality, right? These are grammatical rules in the language, and they have a reason, or they have things that you can analyze. But what about lexicon? So many words, they are idiosyncratic. And they are arbitrary. Arbitrary in a sense, hey, who says T-R-E-E has to mean a tree? Do you see any motivated connection, relation between these four letters and this object? Is there any meaningful connection, conceivable connection? You see, this is what we call arbitrary. So at the beginning, at the dawn of linguistic studies, people don't think words are worth studying simply because they are arbitrary. So we focus mostly on PS rules, syntactic structure. But then, like two decades ago, 20 years ago, lexicon starts to be a major concern of linguistic studies. Why? Why? That's the second part. Semantics. You heard about semantics, right? We used to think semantics is the study of what? Meaning. Okay? So when you talk about semantics, it's more related to meaning. And as we said, words are the basic carriers of meaning. So we start looking at words when your concern is about semantics. But you can also talk about the meaning of a sentence, right? Why individual words? Think back to PS rules. How do you decide the sentence structure How do you decide the structure of a sentence?
By the rule.
But how do you know where the rule should come from? If I have S can sometimes be NP V, right? S can sometimes by NP V NP. Give you an example. John, what?
John fell,
right? John fell. John ran. John died. John slept. Okay? What about this? John?
John
loved Mary. Okay, very good. John loved Mary. Why do you have different structures here? Why do you have two different kinds of PS rules here? Because of the verb. Are you sure? Who decides the structure of a sentence?
The verb needs an object to.
So it's not because of I or John, right? We have the same subject, John, the same thing, right? It's because of the verb. Yes. So we call this what? The verb has what? Subcategorizations. Remember this? Subcategorization. We call it subcategorization because verbs can be put into different categories or groups, right? Verbs like run, fall, jump belong to this category. So it's a subcategory. So verbs subcategorize. And subcategorize what? The elements of the sentence too, right? So verbs can subcategorize the arguments of a sentence. Arguments, one or two arguments, right? Now, if verbs are so important in that they decide the structure of a sentence, then how do we know which verb will subcategorize what? So people begin to think, you need to know how verbs subcategorize things. Once you get that question, you'll have to know the meaning of the verb. Why run, jump, fall only subcategorize one argument, while love, hit, sorry, okay, kick, will have to subcategorize two arguments. Why? Are they arbitrary? No. What is the major factor there?
Meaning behind the word.
Yes, the meaning of the verb. Meaning by the sense a verb encodes some kind of an action, event, activity that you do, right? So if I jump, look at me. If I jump, who is involved? How many people are involved? How many participants are there? Just one. This action, this activity, only involves one participant. I can jump day and night. I can jump to death without affecting any other people, right? So the meaning of run decides the number and the rows of its participants. And then in turn, this decides how you express a sentence. While hit, kick, you can see from the action how many people are involved. Two. And this is the clear distinction between transitive versus intransitive, right? We memorized transitive, intransitive from the very beginning, and we forgot all verbs are there to help you to express real events in the world. So there are simply two kinds of events. One involves only one participant, like jump. And this is what we call 不及物. So what does 不及物 mean?不及物 meaning 不及于另一物 Got it? 不及于另一物 And the other kinds of action Okay? 及于另一物 Yeah! 这样懂了吗？这就是及物跟不及物的区分我从小就觉得这几个词很奇怪一直到我读了语言学我终于知道哦，及物就是及于另一物嘛那为什么每个语言都有及物不及物就是因为有这两种事件嘛 ，OK？ 那我们刚刚用的 love 为什么也 involve？ 你说 I love， can you say I love？ 你会不会想要知道 you love what？ So naturally you have to fill in that slot that piece of information in order to have a complete meaning. You don't say I hit， OK？ I kick， I love， yeah， in a certain context.Okay, you can say, I have the ability to love. But normally, okay, normally, as I said, the rule of linguistics is always a majority rule. In the majority cases, when you use the verb love, you have to say you love whom, you love what. Okay? And the reason why I mention these things, I want you to have a very clear idea from the very beginning what we are talking about here. We are talking about words,We are talking about the meanings of words which have a consequence in the grammar, in the language. We don't just talk about word meanings that have no consequence in language. What do I mean by consequence in language? What do I mean by consequence in language?It has some kind of inference in the grammar. Word order is one of them. Okay? There might be things that really don't matter in the grammar. For example, you have different color terms, right? Green versus red. So color, is color a factor in the language? I mean, in the grammar. So red will have a certain structure.Green will have a certain structure. Do they matter? Red or green? No, because red and green will behave almost in the same way, right? But red, green versus old and young might have a difference.So when we talk about meaning, you have to be aware that we are talking about categories of meaning. Okay? So color will be one factor. Age could be another factor. But within the domain, each individual item may not be that different grammatically. So this course is designed to introduce students to the fascinating field of lexical semantics.The study of what? The interaction of syntactic behavior or syntactic structure and semantic properties. As I said, the semantic properties of the verb will have a consequence in the syntactic behavior, in the grammar. Lexical semantics can be approached from different perspectives with different concerns.And this class is meant to introduce all major approaches that have shed important light on the study of lexical knowledge and representation. What do I mean by lexical knowledge? A lot of people ask what linguistics is all about. And most of you are linguistics majors, right? People might ask you the same question. What are you studying? Linguistics. What is linguistics? Linguistics is the study of language. Then why do you study language? We are studying what people know about language and what language has, right? So representation, lexical knowledge, meaning as a native speaker, you can make certain distinctions. You know certain things that's in your brain or your mind, whatever, right? And as a linguist, we need to represent that knowledge so that people know how language functions. Okay? So what is the nature of lexical knowledge will be our first topic. And how do we represent it? This is a very important question. Okay? Representation is one big thing in linguistics. Formal syntax, they are really strong at or good at is the representation. They have a tree to represent the structure, right? So how do you represent the knowledge is very important. Lectures and class discussions will focus on the major theoretical frameworks and their applications. We learn theories and we'll have to know how these theories can be applied to a real case study, a real issue in language. So in the course of the 18 weeks, 12 major approaches will be introduced. Wow, 12. Why do I select so many things? Because there are so many different frameworks. Some of them are closely related. Some of them may have a different theoretical foundation. The first one is syntax and lexical semantics interface. We will look at Levine first because she is one of the pioneers of lexical semantics, coming from a formal syntactic background. She wrote a book called English Verb Classes and Alternations. Alternations meaning syntactic alternations, alternations of argument expressions. You can decide which verbs belong to the same group by looking at their argument expressions. So how do I know jump is different from hit? I look at their syntactic behaviors. Meaning is something abstract. How do you know these verbs share certain meanings? The only evidence you have is their behavior. How do you know the personality or the psychological state of a person? How do I know you? How do I know your personality? How do you analyze a person's personality? You look at what? You observe their behavior. Same thing in linguistics. You observe the word's behavior, syntactic behavior, so that you know what's behind it. So interface meaning, okay, there's an interaction between what's out there to be observed, syntax, and what's behind, semantics, okay? And the second one, prototype. Well, look at Doughty. You heard about semantic roles, right? Like agent, patient. Have you heard about this? Yes, okay? As I said, these two nouns with the verb hit, John hit Mary or John loved Mary. The semantic role of John and Mary are different. John is what? The one who's doing the action or who is initiating the relation, right? Mary is someone who receives the action. So these different semantic roles are the basic semantic components we talked about. But then you will have to know all these semantic roles are based on some kind of a prototype, right? So when you say John hit Mary, John is clearly an agent, right? But what about John loved Mary? Syntactically, they are both transitive. But John loved Mary. Would you say John is still an agent? You are not that sure, right? So How do we define these semantic relations? There's prototypical relations, and there are non-prototypical relations. So how do we define agent and patient? Okay, we'll talk about prototype features. And then the third one is construction grammar. Some of you have taken my functional syntax, so you should have some ideas about construction grammar. And most of the freshmen don't have this training yet. But it's very simple to understand. Construction, we used to think construction is like a sentence, right? But construction can just be one lexical item, or a phrase, or a short sentence, or a longer sentence. Construction simply means the same thing as I just defined what words are. For example, if I said John, tree, Mary, desk, you know what the meanings are, right? What you think a construction is. For example, I would say MP, V, MP, MP. I'm giving you a syntactic template, a construction, right? We used to think the meaning of the construction is the combination of all these elements, right? So the meaning of construction is the combination of the words, the individual words. We never think construction itself can have meaning. But look at this pattern. What kind of verb you will put in? Give. Very good. We can put give there. What else? Send. What else?
Rent.
Very good. What else? Recommend something to someone. You have to have two, right? And look at these verbs that you put here. Do they share certain meaning? Give, send, rent. What is in common among these verbs? How do you know you have to put these verbs in? If construction has no meaning, how do you know? So, construction grammar simply flip around saying, hey, this pattern must have some kind of meaning so that you know you have to put these verbs in. Okay? Just like a transitive pattern. If I give you something weird, I say, John. Okay. Look at this. What does that mean? John called Mary. Okay? Do you understand the sentence? You don't exactly know what action is involved, but what do you know? You know something, right? John called Mary. Exactly. You know this action must involve another person. John did something to Mary. This is what you know. And that's the meaning of the construction. So you don't exactly know the meaning of the verb, but you know how to interpret the sentence to a certain degree, right? So construction have meanings. And why we talk about construction grammar? Because construction meaning will be mapped or will interact with verb meanings. Okay? So we'll talk about how do we look at word meanings or verbal meanings from a constructional point. Number four, conceptual semantics. This is by Jeckendorf. All these scholars are very famous in lexical semantics, and all their works are classics. Okay? Conceptual semantics, Jeckendorf. Again, they are trying to tear meaning down into more basic, more fundamental elements. Okay? So what is the meaning of I am a student? I am in Jiao Da. I love him. There are certain meaning components that organize our conceptual structure. It's called conceptual semantics, meaning everything in the lexicon is related to our conceptual structure of the world. Okay? How do you conceptualize the world? There are certain basic components that you perceive, and meaning are built upon these conceptual constructs. We'll get to more details and concrete examples. I'm just giving you a rough idea at this point. So conceptual semantics, Jeckendorf, especially spatial constructions. A lot of things are based on what we call a local list view, spatial relation. Okay? For example, I'm good at English. At is a spatial concept. Okay? I'm with someone. Again, it's a special concept. So our conceptual structure, the most basic elements might be related to spatial relations. Next one, frame semantics. Frame, have you heard about frame before? No. Yes. We found certain verbs are related to each other. For example, sell. When I say sell, what do you think about? If I mention sell, what would you think about after hearing the word sell?
Merchandise.
Okay, what else? Buy, right? Yeah. Sell, buy. What else? Money, right? Goods, stores. So you'll see a lot of frames exist in our brain or in our lexicon. Certain words are more closely related to each other in what we call a frame, a framework, a schema. Okay, if I mention going to a restaurant, what would you think about? What would you think about? I went to a restaurant yesterday. Oh, I actually went to Green Garden. 有没有听过？在北大路上的，你听过没有？去过 ？Okay, it's a very good Italian restaurant. So when I mentioned I went to a restaurant, what would you think about?
You had.
I had a meal. Okay, so food. What else?A place, right? Waiters and waitresses. Okay? How much it costs. So things are actually structured into frames. And the reason why we talk about frame semantics because you have to know the frame before you can define a verb. In other words, things are mutually definable. If you don't know what buy is, how do you define sell? You can only define sell in the frame of financial transaction, right? Because of this is the background knowledge for these verbs. Because we have transactions, that's why we have buy and sell. If in our society there's nothing you can buy or sell, then you don't havethese verbs. So the background knowledge actually help us to understand the meaning of verbs. This is frame semantics. Cognitive semantics and configuration. Okay, Lenacker. I bought these books just to show you. Lenacker wrote a book called Foundation of Cognitive Grammar. Foundation of Cognitive Grammar. What is the foundation of our cognition?And he uses configurational representation to show how meaning are connected. Okay? And again, we'll see he is good at talking about certain things, while other people will have different strong points. So this is called cognitive grammar. But what is the main idea?Which might be different from the next one, is called cognitive semantics and lexicalization. Okay? Lenacker's focus is on configurational relation, image schemas, how these things can be spatially represented. But then tell me, the next one, Tellme wrote a book called Toward a Cognitive Semantics. Don't be afraid, we are not going to read all these books, okay? I selected certain chapters from each book. And this is called cognitive semantics, same thing, right? Cognitive semantics. But his focus is on the semantic component of words. For example, go versus enter, okay? How do you differentiate these two verbs? How do you distinguish them? What's the difference between go versus enter? Go, you go there, right? Enter, how do you translate enter? You will say go into. So go is just a motion, okay? You don't know anything else. So the semantic component in the verb go is very simple. It's a motion. But enter involves another component besides motion, right? It's motion plus what? Into. Okay? So there's path, and there might be some other things. Go into, meaning enter. So what is the meaning component in enter? According to Tommy, he will use some component labels like path, manner, motion, figure, ground, these kind of things. Okay? Cognitive semantics and metaphorical extension, oh, the third one. I'll explain later why they are all called cognitive semantics. Okay, Lakoff. This book is very interesting. It's called Women, Fire, and Dangerous Things. What do you think they have in common?
They are all dangerous.
Okay, totally wrong. This is exactly what Lakoff wants to say, okay? People have very simple cognitive mechanism called categorization. We categorize things, right? When you put these things together, we immediately will think, what's in common? Okay, what's shared by all these three items? But then Lakoff, using a very interesting language, Derbal, in Austronesian language families, to show that categorization might involve a lot of things. Okay? So although these things are put in the same category, but they actually have different reasons. So cognition or categorization is very subjective. Very subjective. How do we conceptualize or realize the world? We base everything from our bodily experiences, from our interaction with the world. Okay? There is a case study in this book, Over. We will only look at one case study in this book, the English preposition over. Why do we have so many different uses of over? The class is over. Okay? The airplane flew over the fence. Different things. Turn over the page. So why is one lexical item or one preposition over can have so many different meanings? How do we explain this? All these different meanings are products from our cognitive processes. So what are the basic mechanisms in our cognition? Metaphorical extension, metonymic extension. Have you heard about this? What's a metaphor? What's a metonym? 有没有听过这些字? 没有. Give you a very simple example, a metaphor. 中秋节已经走了, 教师节快要来了. This is a metaphor. A very common sentence, a very usual, right? Normal, high frequency sentence we use every day. It's a metaphor. Why it's a metaphor? 中秋节 Can 中秋节 walk? No. But we describe this as what? Yes. Or we conceptualize the passing of time as spatial movement. Spatial meaning 空间的 So 中秋节走了 Spatial movement. 教师节快来了你们看到时间的改变时间的移动就好像空间的移动这就是一个时空转换所以 metaphor 基本上就是讲 you interpret or conceptualize one thing in terms of another things in one domain is realized experienced conceptualized as in another domain在文学的修辞里面我们把 metaphor 只当作一种修辞所以我说今天的天空好希腊我们就说这是一个 metaphor 如果是 simile 就会说今天的天空像明白吗湛蓝的海洋如果你加了像它就不是 metaphor 了这是文学家说的那语言学家说 metaphor 根本就是一种认知机制 OK 你没有别的方法 You cannot live without metaphors 你每天说话都在用所以我今天的心情很低荡我昨天的心情很高昂你有没有看到你明明是在讲心情可是你用的词汇是什么你用的概念是什么低跟高低跟高是什么是方位这就是 metaphor 所以这是语言学家说的 metaphor 根本就是你认知机制的一个很基本的东西 a very fundamental mechanism in human cognition可以吗 So now get to the question Why all these approaches are called cognitive semantics? 而是 formal semantics Logical semantics 有没有听过这些 So cognitive semantics simply saying meaning is attached to, is associated with our cognitive mechanism. 但是 formal semantics or logic semantics 把 meaning 当成是数学 Okay? Simple representation, simple manipulation, simple computation. Okay? 所以完全是一个不同的方向来看 meaning. 那如果Meaning is like mathematic symbols. 如果语义跟数学是相同的，那这就是一种比较客观的研究。Meaning does not involve the perceiver or the user of the language. 因为一加一等于二，不管谁用都一样。来，所以它是比较客观的。可是 cognitive semantics 从一开始就讲 meaning 是主观的。Very subjective, because meaning is built by the meaning perceiver. 这样懂吗？所以同样是一棵树，我们对它的认知理解可能是不一样的。同样是一场演讲，每一个人对它的 interpretation 是不一样的。那每一个语言对 meaning 的理解和认知也是不一样的。所以我们就在看，到底认知跟语义之间有什么关系？那这就叫做 cognitive semantics 只要是从这个角度出发的都叫 cognitive semantics OK generative lexicon 那为什么会讲到这个呢就是因为 generative 你们都在 syntax 里面学过 generative syntax 最早期 Chomsky 所主张的就是 syntax 可以 generate things 那什么叫 generative lexicon 也是Meaning 是可以被 generated 如果你找到一些 basic 的 principles OK 那 Pujovsky 呢用一个很简单的例子他说 Meaning 其实是有很多不同的意面的那这些意面是 predictable 所谓 generative 就是我可以 generate things 那我只要给你一定的 principle 我就可以 predict 你会 generate 什么东西所以当我们在谈 meaning 你怎么去切分 meaning OK你什么叫做 meaning one, meaning two? Meaning 跟 meaning 之间到底有什么关系？ Pujovsky 用一个很简单的 example， 他说：“你看 book 这个词哈，我们说 book 已经够简单了吧 ？What's the meaning of book？ Well, here's the book, right？ But in real use, they may refer to different things. For example, I might say, look at this book. It's really thick and heavy. Okay， 这时候的 book 我在指什么？It's a physical object. It's thick and heavy, right? Physical object. 但我如果说 look at this book. It's very interesting to read. 我 refer 的是什么 ？Content of the book. Okay? 然后我也可以说 oh, I just wrote a book. How did you get the book? I bought it from a bookstore.这个 book 是怎么生成的 ？I wrote it， 又是一个不同的意面 ，OK？ 所以一本书如果有这么多不同的意面，这些意面本身是可以 predict 的，这就是 generative lexicon 要讲的。我们可不可以从一些既定的规则中，因为 again 还是跟认知有关的，一本书牵涉到哪些面向，我们 perceive 的角度不一样？是不是就可以产生出不同的意念 ？OK。接着 ，grammaticalization and semantic change。那最后要讲到的是，语言会改变 ，language is changing every day。这是 the basic belief, right, of linguistics. If language is changing, then word meaning is also changing.所以你可以想想看，从孔老夫子的《论语》《孟子》到今天，中文里面有多少词汇有改变？今天我们看到很多词是一个多义词，原因是什么？举个例子，过。你看中文里面的过，你怎么用过？你中秋节过得好吗？你这个月过得好吗？这是一个 meaning。我吃过饭了 ，OK？ 你吃过没？我吃过了。你可以越过这座桥吗？我已经讲了三个不同的过了 ，right？ 过得如何 ？Spending time， 吃过，这个过变成一个 grammatical marker， 表示我曾经经历过的 experiential marker， 有点像完成式，对不对？吃过了，吃了。第三个，你可以过桥吗？是什么 ？Motion， pass over。哎，为什么今天有这三个过？三个不同的用法，如果你要解释，你就必须看历代的研究。这叫做 grammaticalization。为什么？它本来是一个动词的过，过桥、过生活，是一个很清楚的动词。可是它被 grammaticalize， 意思就是它被 put into the grammar。所以 grammaticalize 这个字很好解释嘛 ？OK， 就是 becoming part of the grammar。grammaticalize 成为一个什么 aspectual marker？ 吃过。睡过觉了没？看过这本书了没？那个完全没有 motion 了，对不对？这样了解吗？所以你要了解词义的变化，你需要了解他们是怎么改变的。Over time， 这就是 grammaticalization 跟 semantic change。一旦你了解了历代 diachronic 的 development， 你对词汇的语义就有更深一层的理解。第十一个是 corpus linguistics。我为什么讲到 corpus linguistics？OK？、Okay?因为这是目前的显学，你知道传统的 formal syntax 的 study 完全 based on what native speakers intuition， but it gets into a big problem. My intuition might be different from yours. 所以我们常会 debate， 比方我说，小明他吃了很多饭，你接不接受这个句子？小明他吃了很多饭，有人说好。有人说不太好 ，OK， so you don't know what's truly the intuition. So instead of asking the speaker to make judgments, why don't we just look at real usage? Corpus 都知道这个字哈，语料，语料库。我们就把大家讲的话全部收集起来，然后你从语料库里面可以看到语言的现象。所以从 corpus-based approach， 我们怎么去看 meaning？那 corpus 提供什么样的 resource？ 你可以看到这个词到底跟谁出现在一起。你可以看到很多，也许你的 intuition 以为不是的东西都出现。我举个例子，以前林若望研究的是，我们林若望老师之前在我们系上，他研究 aspect， 所以他说死这个字，我们都知道死就死了嘛，对不对？你不会说他正在死，为什么？因为它不是一个 process， 它不能够 ongoing。你也不会说他死着，对不对？这是我们的 intuition 都会这样讲的。所以林若望的 paper 里面就说，你不会说死着。你不会说他正在死，可是如果你去看语料，你们不信，今天回去查中研院的语料库啊，这些全部都出现，而且还不止一次，了解吗？为什么？因为在某一个 context 之下 ，it makes sense， 他在慢慢死去中，对不对？了解了吗？你加上一些东西就可以了。所以那个概念到底怎么转换的？你如果不看 corpus， 你不了解。所以 Corpus 提供一个比较 empirical 的 database， empirical 这个字动哈，实证的，是你可以去反复验证的。那我们也会看从 Corpus approach 怎么来看 meaning。 最后一个 emergent grammar， 这个是上过 functional syntax 的人可能比较熟。这个 emergent 跟 grammar 放在一起，有没有觉得怪怪的？我们对 grammar 的概念是不是都觉得是 fixed 的？不然你怎么教 grammar？ 我出了一本书叫英文文法有道理， OK，试图去解释所有文法背后这些规则的意义何在。那如果文法不是 fix， 你在解释什么？那 emergent grammar 意思就是 grammar 居然是在什么随时的变动中的。那这是一个很 radical 的 linguistic view， 我们也可以从这个角度来看那 meaning 怎么改变。因为其实它是有道理，如果语言不是 dynamically being shaped， 语言怎么会改变呢？他们只是去讲到那个改变的机制跟改变的那个点，这样了解吗？所以因为语法是变动的，词汇语义也跟着在改变。所以这些所有不同的 approaches 就是 lexical semantics 这个领域里面最重要的一些著作。你把这十二个 approach 了解了，几乎没有什么是你不懂的了。那你说老师，你怎么把这十二个全部教给我们？我每一个 approach 选一到两篇的文章，我们做深入的研究讨论，你就至少知道这个人在讲什么。那如果以后你要用他的东西来做分析， you know how to apply and what to apply， 而这些才是你写论文最重要的。你知道论文基本上是什么？你有一个问题，你有一个 issue， 然后你去观察语料，你去收集语料。那我们基本上都鼓励大家用 corpus， OK。其实现在 formal 的人他们也开始用 corpus， 有些人也开始用，因为这只是一个工具，要了解。那你看了 corpus 之后呢，重点是你要想出一套分析方法解释原则，对不对？这才是真正的功力嘛。我举个例子，我上个学期五个研究生毕业，其中有一个研究生他做几，也许到了 the end of the semester we will haveSome time to look at this paper。 中文的几从来没有人做过，我们就发现几很好玩啊。你听着啊，我可以说你怎么这么晚啊？今天公车很挤， OK， 我挤不上公车。然后我也可以说大卖场怎么样，人挤人。我还可以说什么，挤牛奶，挤牙膏。这么多种几的用法，你观察到了，你的语料中你可以看到，哦，一二三四五六七 ，seven different patterns。But then, how do you explain how these different usage will be interrelated? Explanation 在哪里 ？Analysis 在哪里？你就可以用任何一个 framework 去解释。如果你用Lakoff 的 approach， 你就要想到这当中有没有牵涉到 metaphorical extension。 如果你用 Talmy 的 approach， 你就要想想究竟几它的 lexical component 是什么，那个最基本的成分是什么。如果你用 Lineker 的角度，你就要看它有呈现一种什么样的 schema configuration， OK， 然后我是可以去 profile certain things， 所以它的 base schema 是什么，然后我 profile 的又是什么。如果你用 construction grammar， 那你就要看到你是不是可以解释每一个 用法就像是一个 construction， 然后这些 construction 之间有没有什么关联，这样懂吗？那有一些的 issue 可能用某一个 approach 是比较容易解释的，那就要看你到时候选择什么样的 approach， 而且能够看到什么样的关联，这样可以吗？所以我花这么多时间解释是因为你一定要先了解整个 lexical semantics 为什么会出现。 Each theoretical framework will be illustrated with respective papers, representative papers that show the basic constructs of the theory and how the approach can be applied to the analysis of a linguistic issue. 这才是重点，这样好吗？然后我为什么会教这门课，因为我自己就在做 lexical semantics 的 study， 这是我近十年研究的一个方向。那你说老师你怎么会做这个？我之前是做 functional syntax 的， OK， 所以我也教你们 functional syntax， 但是就像我说的， the frontier of linguistic study 已经 move from syntax to lexical semantics， from sentence structure to word structure， 特别是 verb， 所以 verbal semantics 就是我在做的。那我们一组一组的动词在做，我做的当然是中文，因为 I'm a native speaker of Chinese， 所以我们做 Chinese verbs， Mandarin verbs， 那我们做一组一组的，就意思就是 communication verbs， cognition verbs， perceptual verbs， motion verbs， OK， 那每一组的动词它就建构出一个 frame， 我们刚刚已经讲过一个 frame 就是一个 background 的 schema， OK，这些动词彼此 related， in what way they are related， in what way they are distinct， OK， 所以我在做的叫做 Mandarin Verb Net， 那这个 construction of Mandarin Verb Net 也会是我们其中一个礼拜的主题，让你们知道我们做了些什么，我们在做什么， OK。 那 the ultimate goal of this class is to provide students with a broad range of background knowledge that will enable you to carry out meaningful researchin lexical semantics， 有没有问题？我刚讲了这么多，有没有哪个词你不了解的？我记得曾经有一个同学问我说，老师这个有没有什么 prerequisite， 我说没有，我说没有的原因是因为这堂课是一个新的课， OK， 它牵涉到很多即使三年级四年级的同学也没听过的，所以有没有 background 不重要，重点是我每一次提的时候你理解，我每次在解释的时候你能够 follow， 这样了解。所以刚刚的整个的解释过程中有没有什么不理解的？
是那个
Yes
configuration 跟 metaphor 这两个我觉得
Yeah configuration。 好，什么叫 configuration？ 比方我们说 formal syntax 是非常 configurational 的，为什么？因为它就是一个 tree， figure 知道 figure 的意思吗？就是一个图像，那 configuration 就是有图像化的。Metaphor 是完全只是你的一种认知转换，它是一种 conceptual transfer， 这样了解吗？
One is concrete and the other is actual。
不要这样子讲，因为 configuration 就是它用图像去解释语义关系，它这两个是可以 combine 的。那 metaphor 在讲的是我那个认知转换的原则是什么，这样懂了吗？我可以用认知转换的原则让我的 configuration 也有某些改变嘛。所以我举个例子，什么叫 configuration？ 就是我去解释语义。我觉得这是一个很好的问题哈，我们来看一下。比方我可以说，我用 to 这个例子好了。你知道英文的 go to， 这个 to， 我怎么解释它的语义？我可以用 Lineker 的这个 configurational 说 to involve 一个 path from A to B， 这就是一个 configuration。这样了解了吗？我为什么这样说？因为 to 你可以说 come to me， to 有一个方向性， OK， 那它跟 go 在一起的时候就会有一个 path， 可是基本上它一定是一个方向性。那我怎么去 represent 这个方向性？我是不是可以用一个 configuration 去 represent？ 然后什么是 metaphor？ 我说 go to the classroom，OK， 这是很清楚的一个 spatial 的嘛， right？ Go to the classroom， come to the classroom。 那我可不可以从 space 很清楚的空间，我再把它转换到一样的，我保留这个 schema 哦， 我说 we came to a conclusion. 你这样了解吗？所以当我说 we come to a conclusion 的时候，已经没有 involve 真正的 motion 了嘛，没有空间的移动了嘛。所以从 motion 到 non-motion， 这个转换就叫做 metaphor， 这样懂了吗？所以不同的人他强调不同的面向，可以了吗？所以你要怎么解释我为什么会用中秋节过了，然后教师节要来了，我怎么解释我用来跟过？ Lakoff 的解释就是说，这是一个 metaphor， it involves a metaphor， 什么样的 metaphor？ 从空间转换到，从时间转换到空间的这个时空转换，时空转换就是一个 metaphor， 这样懂了吗？ OK， 那你要怎么解释过？你可以用一个 schema 来解释过，牵涉到你有某一个 landmark， 然后过一定是什么？这是不是就是一个 configurational 的分析？这样懂吗？很好，还有没有别的不了解的？所以很多 linguistic term 哈，你 again 你第一个要回到的是它的词汇意义本来是什么，然后再去理解它在语言学里面有什么样的特殊的地方。可是它还是基本一定有一个基本的语义嘛。Okay, we've explained the objectives of this class, and then here are some details you need to know. Textbooks. There is a required reading packet, which will be available tomorrow in the library copying room. As I said, I selected several papers for each, one to two papers for each approach, and we compile all the papers into a reading packet.OK， 那 supplementary 呢？是我写了一本书啊，我居然没带来，叫做 Lexical， 叫做 Mandarin Verbal Semantics。这是我早年这本书大概已经是十年前出的了哈。那时候 corpus-based approach 刚刚才出现 ，so at that time it's a new approach， and I wrote this book called Mandarin Verbal Semantics: A Corpus-based Approach.If you are interested, you can get this book as a supplementary reader, but it's not required. Okay? 有没有问题？那如果你觉得 reading packet 不够清楚，你可以上网去看那些网站上你可以找到的也可以哈。但是 for your convenience, I've already compiled a reading packet for you. 最后我很简单的讲一下我们的 weekly schedule 哈。Reading 的部分，请你们自己注意哈。那每一个 reading 呢，我都已经把它写出来了，而且给你们很详细的 reference。那我的 reading 是 I use reading 1, reading 2 as week 1, week 2 来 organize 它们。所以 reading 2 意思就是 readings for week 2。那你有两篇，我说过哈，通常就是两篇。这个礼拜我们回去会读一个很简单的东西，马乔词典。马乔是一个地点，什么地点呢？就是屈原投江自尽的地方，还记得屈原吗？端午节的由来，听过这个人啊？读过他的诗吗？屈原是什么朝代的人？
在
楚国的一个大宰相，一个大臣啊。那他后来为什么自尽？他有一句什么叫什么？他死之前他说什么？众人皆罪我独醒，灼灼魂事啊！他最后选择自杀。所以这个地方呢，它有很多的词汇很有意思。你想，它叫词典，就是它解释一个词，然后呢，就告诉你它后面的文化意义。那我用这个作为一个很轻松的开场，就是让你们体会到词汇后面包含了多少丰富的知识。这些知识可能是文化的，是社会的，是个人的。那特别马乔这个地方有一些很有意思，比方他们的田是什么意思？它跟外面是不一样的。刚刚说醒，你知道他们骂人哦，骂人傻瓜叫什么？他是个醒子。为什么他骂人是醒子，而不是你这个沉睡昏睡的人呢？OK， 所以我要你们先去体会 从简单的文化意义去体会词汇的丰富。所以这是我们的第一个 reading。 所以我们来看一下哈，基本上今天我会花一点时间解释 What is a lexicon? Culture is reflected in the lexicon。 就像我刚刚说的，为什么醒子是骂人的话？因为跟屈原有关。屈原说众人皆醉我独醒，结果这个醒着的人做了什么事？自杀了。 OK， 做了最傻的事。所以傻子是醒子。好，那下礼拜开始我们会谈 The Nature of Lexical Knowledge， 还有呢语义词汇语义一个最基本的问题。你们过去在 Intro to Linguistics 应该也学过 Ambiguity 跟 Vagueness 的问题。那大部分的词就像我刚举的放啊挤啊，其实几乎所有的词都有 polysemy 的问题，多义性的问题。那我们至少先定义清楚这些概念，接着我们就会按照刚刚介绍的一个一个的来讲。